Here again is another one, and this could be anywhere in the world today. This could be anywhere in the world. This could be all over the world. This was kind of splayed out for freedom. This is one when Bobby and Erica Huggins, who I talked about, were incarcerated, but it's also playing off the conditions of oppression and situations at the same time. This one says Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, Mississippi, California, Chicago, New York, America. Freedom is a constant struggle. This is the one that I took. This is when I talked about the students on the student campus and then battles on the campuses. Well, this is the photograph of one of those students at Rutgers University. And I just happened to, it kind of mirrored this image, so I put them together and used this 10-point platform or program of the Black Panther Party, where it says we want education for our people that exposes the true nature of this decadent American society. We want an education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. So I collaged them together. This one that says, I just want to testify. I'm not going to sit around anymore. I got freedom on my mind. We shall survive without a doubt. These were Panther Cubs. We had an alternative school. They're in their 40s, 30s, late 30s or 40s now. We had an alternative school. We had over 200 kids. Had a waiting list of over 2,000. Considered one of the best alternative schools in the state of California. Had liberation schools across the country. You had people like Sheila E., who used to come to the school and do fundraisers at the school for us. You had Grateful Dead. They've done fundraisers for Santana before he was famous. You had blues singer like John Lee Hooker. All of them have come and done performances for us. You had Abby Lincoln, who was known as a well-known jazz singer, named Almanada Moseka, that was her name, who also came and did some things with it at our school. So we had a lot of support from the cultural community, as well as from political community, all that. Rosa Parks, many people don't know, Rosa Parks. Civil rights leader came to stay with us for 2 weeks in the early 1970s at the school. This says all power to the people, and it's kind of playing like off the fact that what we were talking about, people's power, had people's free health clinics. We had free breakfast programs all across the country for kids who went to school before, so they wouldn't go to school on a hungry stomach. You had the government, one of the politicians back then said the Black Panther Party was feeding more hungry children in the United States government. And it was true. We were. And that's why we became public enemy number one, because we were beginning to change ideals and the people were beginning to demand these kinds of programs. You see, so this is what the impact of the Panthers was about. We had these all across the country. We had free for health clinics. We had doctors and nurses who came in. We had actual medical staff and equipment and stuff to assist people with their needs and give them. We talked about preventative health care. We weren't in the business of trying to manipulate people into coming back to a doctor all the time, but we were trying to show them what was happening so they could maybe get on top of it and get some kind of assistance. We were talking about preventative health care. We had a free ambulance service in Winston-Salem. First chapter we had in the South, we had over 49 chapters and branches throughout the United States. And the first one was in Winston-Salem. Winston-Salem, the Panthers could not get the ambulance to come into the community on a timely manner. So they went and got certified as ambulance drivers, and the community helped them buy an ambulance. So you had the Black Panther Party Community Ambulance Service in Winston-Salem. We had free busing to prison programs for those who wanted to go visit their loved ones who were incarcerated all across the country. Because we knew that if there were people on the outside connected with those who were on the inside, it's a greater chance that they would not go back in as much as they would if there was no link between them and those who were outside and those who were incarcerated. So all across the country, they had to pay no money. Just tell them where to put the information out to call out, that to be at a certain location on X amount of day, on whatever day. They come, first serve, till the buses fill up. They know what prisons we're going to that week, and they'll be there. And that's the way we did it, all across the country. Fight sickle cell anemia. Sickle cell anemia was a disease that predominantly impacted African Americans in this country. And so it was no cure for it, still no cure for it. And so we began to do the testing, free testing, all across the country, free testing with doctors and stuff. As you can see, some of this happening in here. And you had people who found out they couldn't understand why they were feeling the way they were. And it was because they had the sickle cell. Never known it before. You had a Panther who wrote a book. And in his book, he said it wasn't until he took the test as a Panther that he found out what his problem was. He had sickle cell from the test. So the government wasn't doing anything in conjunction with this. It was the Panthers beginning to enlighten and inform the community about these things that were going on. This was in 1939. You had these black sharecroppers. I think it was 99 sharecroppers or more who couldn't read or write, and they were offered $50 each to be in this. And that was a lot of money to them to be in this test. It's called a Tuskegee experiment. It was related to syphilis disease. Didn't have a cure for it then. In 1947, they found a cure for it, and it was penicillin. But they didn't give those black sharecroppers the penicillin. They kept them in the study. They kept them in the study until 1972. Between 1947 and 1972, they were going blind, they were dying, they were passing it on to other loved ones and family. And in 1972 was when these progressive reporters got this, had done this investigative reporting and couldn't get it published in the daily newspaper. So they gave it to us and to other progressive newspapers, alternative press. And when we put it in the paper, that's when this test stopped. 1972 was after it was exposed. Before that, if that wouldn't ever come out and it wouldn't have done that reporting and been organizations like ourselves and others, then we never would have known about this. They did the same thing over in one of them countries in South America. I think it was over in Nicaragua. They did the same thing. They took the prostitutes, they took the military people over there and others and tested them, shot them up with these infectious disease to see how it was going to work on them. Obama just gave an apology about a year ago. Same thing he did in the 40s. This has seniors program, Seniors Against a Fearful Environment, and we're called SAFE, they used to come. He had a young lady in the Panther, 15 years old, who used to run this program, named Arlene. They loved her. And we used to pick them up from the satellite houses where they lived, take them shopping, to get their groceries. They used to have do things at our school, which you turn it into a culture center in the evening, where they used to do a lot of programming out of there. On this particular one, it was Oakland was talking about spending this money on, I think it was $54,000 on a helicopter patrol crime in the community. Now what I was saying with this one is that if they're gonna spend that, why spend that $54,000 on a helicopter when they can invest the $54,000 in the young people like this one here to escort the seniors to cash their checks, escort them to pick up their groceries, and engage them in that way. That way you cutting into crime. Then you supporting those youngsters who need the jobs, who are out there, who ain't got no money, and what have you, by investing in them, as opposed to being investing in a $54,000 for a helicopter, and not talking about in relationship to dealing with those who are socially disadvantaged and desperate to survive, and not investing in them. So that becomes hypocritical. It's not about transforming the quality of life.
Maybe one and then two?
Yeah. I was going to say, what advice do you have for young people like ourselves to resolve issues with police brutality?
Well, first you have to come together in yourselves and make some choices on how y'all want to approach it. And this time in resolving, and you can learn from historical situations such as the Panthers and others who have dealt with those issues and continue to deal with those issues. But you have to come involved as a collective in order to make it work. This Black Lives Matter, the whole movement, all that's a broad movement. Whole lot of different organizations, people coming together. But it's transcending communities and what have you. So you have to be outspoken for sure. You have to be know and deal with facts on it for sure. And you have to be persistent, and you have to be continue to stay inspired, but work with those who you feel you can work with in relationship to coming together to deal with those issues. Yeah, but and be informed on them, you know, see what's going on around the world, how people, youngsters are being murdered, beaten down all across the country. I think this whole movement of what's going on in relationship to recent murders has brought worldwide attention to things that people didn't believe was happening anymore. When I traveled to Australia, they tried to think this still don't even exist no more in this country. You know, this is a post-racist society, no problem, none of that. Yeah.
Thank you. My question in regards to that, like what's happening in South Carolina and what's happening like in New York and what's happening like out here in California, with what you said, like people want to believe that we're living in this post-racist society, like the media even tries to perpetuate it as living in this post-racist society that we're talking about. What is the best way to try and get awareness for a society which always tries to like downplay it?
Well, sometimes you got to get in the face. You have to agitate. You can't be passive about it. You have to be able to communicate it. You have to be consistent with it. You know, you have to be, but you have to be, have the conviction within yourself in relationship to wanting to be a part of that transforming of things. I mean, it's a challenge because you're dealing with a system that controls and dictates everything. They wiped out if it wasn't for electronic media now, where you get stuff from all over the world, we wouldn't even have no access to no accurate reports of what's going on. And so it's, you know, you just have to stay consistent and do what you can do in the context and not give up, you know. It's not about quitting. I mean, there's highs and there's lows, there's times and there's frustrations, all that exists. That's about a human nature. But you still got to rise to the challenge in relationship to what needs to be done. And if you see something out there that where you can work in, get involved with it, that's for sure. Yeah. But I would advise you, you know, you have to be conscious of the fact that you just can't go out there sometimes and just confront things because it could get you killed. So you have to be strategic in when you do things as well. Now, also, we talk about the system, a system. That may be good people in them systems, but you may have family members that's police or family members that's part of the system. But it's the culture that dictates the policy that creates the situation that we're in and that exists. All this is going on.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I wish we had more time. Yeah. Can we give Emory a big warm round?
First, I did not make her through both hands.
Thank you.
posture. I just wanted to say that this is our first piece that we wrote. It's about my name, where it comes from, and the title is My Name's Challenge. Yeah, the name is called My Name's Challenge.
Santiago, put the mic close to your
mouth.
Okay.
That
was perfect. Here. Right, a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. Everyone needs to talk right into the mic. Like, brr. Yeah.
Okay. Just...
No, not going.
Santiago Delgado. A long name to speak, but fragile to discuss. Why? Was the question I asked myself every single day on the courtyard of Monroe Elementary School, every time a classmate screamed my name, waving his hands, encouraging me to play another game of soccer. Why did my parents give me a name that sounded so Latin? Why did my parents give me a name that did not match the country that I was in? An English name, yes. More like Robert, Michael, Douglas, anything but Santiago, was my first reaction. Traveling to the smallest village in Mexico, in my eyes, is challenging. Cramped in a minivan where laws aren't enforced in a land controlled by gangs and other mischief people, at any moment you could be stopped and have every possession belong to you taken. Your roots was the phrase my parents and grandparents kept using, as if I was a tree and this was where my seed had originated and carried by the wind across thousands of miles to my true roots. Not this tiny place in the middle of nowhere, in a place that doesn't even have roads, but the stories that I heard sitting on this famous couch that had been passed down generation through generation, sitting in the exact home, was the most memorable thing I had experienced. Your great-grandfather were the first words I heard entering this long-standing home, only to realize that his name was also Santiago Delgado. He lived 99 years, raised over 20 kids, and fought in the Mexican Revolution, one of Mexico's greatest historic movements, where people from all classes came together and fought the country that we see today. I could not have imagined two sentences could have made a profound change to my opinion and vision of my name.
Next, we'll have a poem from Celia Strunk. The witching hour. The stars, the moon, iridescent. The dewy field of emerald grass, luminous. The subtle breeze, tickling the pungent leaves of the eucalyptus trees. Drenched in pearly moonlight, eyes aglow like freshly minted coins. She tries to name the hue of the night sky. Indigo? No. Royal blue? Definitely not. Charcoal? Cobalt? Ebony? The celestial sky, iris of the goddess of the night, ruler of the cosmos, an enigma. Omnipresent to the world below, yet anonymous in color. Next, Luis Martinez.
So this is a little excerpt from my piece, and it's my personal narrative, and it's called The Tragedy of a Comedy. Shakespeare wrote 34 plays and 154 sonnets, and you can't even write a poem to ask your girlfriend's prom. Wait, that's it. You'll ask her out through a sonnet. You suddenly remember her saying how much she loved Shakespeare. You find out that the rhyme scheme is AB, AB, CD, CD, EF, EF, GG. And the sonnets are about something you love. And what better way to express your love for her than to write her a poem while popping the question? That being, will you go to prom? So you start jotting things you love about her and start writing. You had trouble at first, but then what felt like ages, but was only like 45 minutes, you had a finished product. Thou clear thy throat and stand up straight and read thy poem of love not hate. I'm connecting the dots with the many freckles on your cheeks, and they tell me that You do love me, and well, that I'm not just any. You're a spectacle to sit and look at. Your eyes are like that of a deep blue sea. I really, really love your beautiful hair. When we're alone together, I feel free. You make me do things I would never dare. I love that single dimple when you smile, and the way you rock those skinny blue jeans. For this night, maybe we could dance for a while. I'd bet you'd be the queen of queens. So you already know you are the freaking bomb. So how would you like to go with me to prom? So you felt proud of yourself, more proud of yourself than the time you found out that all Fruity Loop colors actually taste the same. Same thing goes with M&Ms. Like, who does that to the people? Anyway, back on track. And you, as the procrastinator you are, you wait a couple days until you finally decide to recite your sonnet to her. And what do you know? She says yes. You know, she was really proud of you for taking the time and care to write this for her. So 2 months go by, and after spending countless hours of planning and choosing the right tux and finding a nice limo for your girlfriend and your friends, you receive a phone call. It's from Bay. You slid your phone with your right thumb, and the cookie crumbled way too hard from there. Just like Drake said, it went 0 to 100 real quick. Your girlfriend had broken up with you, and you didn't have a prom date. Oh, what tragedy. Nobody was stabbed, but it was still sad that you and your girlfriend even both had matching colored shoes. But unlike Shakespearean tragedies, this one didn't have any blood nor a sad ending, because you, as the great guy you are, still managed to go to prom and dance with thy purple shoes.
Now we're going to go from high schoolers at prom to high school-aged Martians with a short story from Atue Hernandez.
I'm Atue Hernandez, and I'm going to be reading excerpt from my story, Lily the Martian. There's a sharp, piercing pain on my arm. I see the water turning ruby red. I look down to see a shark chewing on my arm and looking up at me. It was like we were having a staring contest, except I didn't want to die. I started shimmying my arm, hoping the shark would just bite it clean off so I can swim away. Jump! I let out a small scream because of the pain. I swim in, hit the beach, and just run. My friend is petrified as a man who had just stared down Medusa and turned to stone, except he was staring at my arm. The pain became numbness. I looked at my arm, or what was left of it. My arm ended at my elbow. I yell, "Call my mom! Shouldn't we call an ambulance first?" "No!" I scream. Now you should know, us Martians don't really need a doctor when a limb is lost. It will regenerate faster than the speed of a wildfire spreading. And if you recall, I can't go to a hospital. Once Holden gets a hold of my mom, I tell him to give me the phone so he can get a grip. "Hello, Lily, what's wrong?" she said. "Mom, don't panic. But a shark bit off my arm." "Mikakni!" You can tell she's worried because she just switched to our native Martian language. We use this phrase the same way humans use "oh my god." My mom is now ranting in Martian. She's talking so fast, it's hard for me to understand. I hear the words translates to "dad" come from her scream. I yell, "Don't tell dad!" She got quiet. I don't want my dad to know because he has such high expectations for me. I mean, imagine if he found out his daughter lost half of her arm because of a dare. "Mom, can you just pick me up? My friend is just staring at my arm," so I whisper to him, "Pack up the stuff." What's crappy is I'm about to abandon him here. I can't let him see my arm regenerate.
Our next writer will be Emmanuel Gordon.
I'm going to be reading a story called The Day That Was. Every day is a balance of good and bad. If the scales tip too far, it might be a bad day or even a great day. Most days are equal. Today, however, there are no scales. Alexandra Roslin woke up to a very neutral day. She didn't feel hot or cold, she just was. She stood and her feet touched a floor that was smooth and gritty and warm and cold, like wet sand on a beach after the tides have left and the sun has started shining. She made a breakfast which had no taste, feel, or smell. She ate it without noticing. She went out on her balcony to think. Below, the cars rolled by as if the drivers had somewhere to go, but had no sense of urgency. Small dots of people rushed around indifferently, carrying out their tasks as quickly and quietly as they could. The whole city was engulfed in an absence of noise. No one was shouting or honking or screeching or steaming or screaming or humming or buzzing. Everything was under a cloak of quiet. The only sound was the rushing of the wind, brave enough to break the silence. The sky was above was blue, with occasional clouds overlaid on the ceiling of the world. Most days, Alexandra's mind felt like a train station, filled with people and trains rushing about. Today, though, her mind was quiet, still, and empty, like fog rolling silently over the land. It calmed her. She felt at peace with herself and the world returned the sentiment. She didn't feel happy or sad, she just was. Because for the first time, everything and everyone was just wasn't.
Next we have JC Joseph.
The mind trip of impermanence. There she stands at the edge of the stately crimson-colored cliff. As she stares down into the valley, she can see multiple fields of green rolling hills following a single crystal blue river that stretches into the distance. Looking straight ahead, she can see the sun glaring back at her with vivid beams of pink and red. She waits with an immense patience for the sun to go down, sadly knowing it will not stay here forever. It will disappear into the night and will rise again to repeat the cycle of time. She takes a long breath, feeling the cool air fill her lungs with the intoxicating colors of the setting sun. Then she slowly moves forward to soak in the light, only to jolt back into an awakened state and realize it was all just a dream.
And for the last writer I have the pleasure of emceeing for, Julie Abbott-Ball.
I'm going to be reading a short story called Chemical Reaction. In the flames, I see Buster lying at my feet. Get up, Buster, I shout, but he only lifts his head slightly, his watery eyes pointed in my direction, looking at me but not really seeing me. I kneel next to him, trying to ignore the sweltering heat, the smoke filling my lungs. Come on, Buster, come on, boy, get up. Please get up. His tail thumps weakly, once, twice, but that is the only move he makes. Come on, I choke out between coughs. I'm not leaving without you. I grab his collar and haul him to his feet. Then I half shove, half lead him out the door. With my shoulder, I thrust it open, and we spill out into the hallway. I cough violently, holding a hand over my watering eyes and looking through cracked fingers and trying to see through the thickening smoke. Everything looks different when it's burning, but there at the end of the hall, I can see the doorway. The doorway. I'm going to make it out. I'm going to live. And I'm taking this huge, stupid, wonderful German Shepherd with me, sickness or no sickness. Mom and Dad will get Gabe out, and we'll all... I stop short, my stomach's sinking. Mom and Dad are at their gala event, far away from the smoke and the flames. And where's Gabe? And now I hear a sound that I hadn't heard over the crackling wood and the sound of my own heartbeat. Gabe screams, faint, coming from the opposite end of the house. A fire is a strange substance. No, not a substance, a chemical reaction, lacking matter. It's often thought of as a malicious entity, violent, hungry, all-consuming. But as I gaze at my home burning around me, there's a strange beauty in the flames, streaks of golden orange like rays of the setting sun, the flames licking at the wood elegantly, even gently. Wood shifting, changing, from shades of mahogany and chestnut to charred black. Metal slowly drooping in the heat, wilting like flower petals. Plumes of smoke delicately curling upward, swirling gray. And I don't feel sadness or despair. All I feel is childlike bewilderment, because I don't understand. It doesn't make any sense that something this beautiful is going to kill my dog. There isn't time for a tearful goodbye, to tell him how much I love him. I only look at him and whisper, I'm sorry, before I turn, and without looking back, plunge down the hall and into my little brother's room. Don't think, just go. He stops screaming now and is just sitting on his bed, rocking back and forth. He's been crying, the tears left streaks behind on his soot-caked face. But by now, he stopped crying, too. A heavy fallen ceiling beam, cracked and splintered, is lying on his leg. I sprint up to him. He doesn't say anything, doesn't move as I wrap my arms around the plank. A thousand splinters dig into my arms as I pull it off his leg, my eyes watering with the effort and the soot, my breath heaving. My smoke-filled lungs are slowly collapsing until finally the wooden beam crashes to the ground. His leg is bent at an odd angle, his foot pointing the wrong way. I push back the nausea that has attempted to rise from the pit of my stomach. Leaning down, I lift him off the bed. He clings to me, but his eyes are empty, like Buster's were a moment ago. Don't think, just go. Something massive crashes in a different room. We don't have much time. I carry him out the door and head down the hallway in the opposite direction of where I left Buster. No, don't think, just go. I don't look up or down, left or right, I just look forward. I force myself to keep moving and not to glance around at our disintegrating house. I hear a crack and I don't look up. I just lean over and try to shield Gabe's body with my own as a shower of sparks rains down. And then we're outside, tumbling into the frigid night air. We gasp for breath as I set Gabe on the ground and collapse onto the ash-stained concrete next to him. The clear, sweet air feels wonderful and yet unsettling, as if I have already become unaccustomed to the lack of soot in the air. We weren't a minute too soon. We watch as our house begins to crumble. I lie down and stare up at the sky, the smoke, city smog, and light pollution joining forces to blot out the stars. I close my eyes. In the distance, I hear sirens, the wail of danger, danger, danger. But I don't pay attention. They're too late.
And now, our very special guest on GTFU America. They made waves in 1999 with their hit song, Girl, Let Me Boost Your Self-Esteem. And have been legends ever since. Please welcome Zane and CJ of To Be True!
Be performing on this awesome stage sponsored by V-Mobile. Hell yeah! All right, well, let's get to the first fan question, dude.
Oh, yeah, dude, okay, yeah. I'm gonna read them.
Okay, first fan question comes from Julie in Arkansas. Hey, Julie.
What's up?
She says, how did you get your start?
How did To Be True begin?
Good question, Julie. You know, I was just a young boy singing in my church choir when I got started. I was singing for spare change in the New York City subway. I remember I was so poor, I had to call the producer back on a payphone. Luckily, there are such affordable data plans now.
Yeah. Let's get to the next question.
Okay. Next question's from Sarah in Charleston. Hey, Sarah.
What's up?
Is there anything you'd like to say to your tried and to-be-true fans?
Aw,
the ones who have loved you since the very beginning.
Wow, yeah.
Nice one.
We really feel like we know our biggest fans, because, like, they've been writing us letters for so long. It seems like just yesterday we were getting all these letters about how they wish boys in their junior high were more like us, yeah. And now we're getting college graduation photos. It's crazy. But seriously though, I'd like to thank the parents who actually brought all our fans to the shows and bought all the CDs.
Yeah, mad respect. Mad respect. And I'm excited to announce that because we love our fans so much, we're offering an exclusive discount on the new special edition To Be True glitter phone from V-Mobile. Hell yeah! Yeah, it comes preloaded with To Be True ringtones. It's got a shortcut app to our Twitter page and all kinds of other awesome stuff. A true, true fan has to have one.
Well, I mean, a true, true fan loves our music, right? Get the phone, though.
Anyway,
question. Yeah, now let's do one more.
Okay, this one comes from a Francisco. Hey, what's up? Okay, so he says, whatever happened to Brian, the former third member of To Be True? Are you all still best friends like in your song, My Boys Can Get Down? Good question.
There's been a lot of speculation about Brian ever since the Madison Square Garden incident, but the fact is, Brian and I have artistic differences. That's really all it was. You know how it is, but I hear he's doing really good. I mean, I wish the guy the best.
Yeah, no, Brian's doing great. Me and him are closer than ever. We're always messaging through the Hit Me Up app on To Be True Glitter Phone. It's like a really good way to stay in touch by taking like funny selfies and sending like cute stickers. I do wish that guy was still around though.
Well, he did get a strap from the label.
But now things are better than ever thanks to our sponsorship by the V-Mobile Corporation. Yeah! Actually, I want to tell them. I'm too excited. I've got to tell them.
Wait, wait.
I'm excited to announce that in 2016, we will be releasing a brand new album! Yeah! And True True fans will be able to get a direct download exclusively to their To Be True Glitter Phone from V-Mobile. Hell yeah!
I don't even know what direction that album's taking.
Well, I also want to say, like, on a personal note, like, V-Mobile's amazing communications technology has opened up like whole new fan bases for us.
Oh yeah, that's true. We were so honored to be invited to perform at the San Francisco Pride Festival this year. I mean, taking a stance for justice and acceptance with our music.
And if that's a stance you want to take all the time with everything you do, you have to get the new To Be True Rainbow Phone from V-Mobile. That's right, it has the 1-2 Step app, which teaches classic To Be True choreography, and also comes preloaded with Grindr. To Be True Rainbow, text with pride.
All right, why don't we just get to what they came for, which is the music.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
Well, this song has been named a V-Mobile Classic Jam, trademark.
Corporate bullshit!
You think we could get this audience without corporate bullshit?
Man, this sounds
We've been manufactured since the beginning. We've been sellouts since day one. But now we have a choice, man. We can give up now, or we can tell them the story about the call that changed our destiny. Text with pride!
My name is Evan Anderson. I live in San Francisco, California. Skating has taught me about myself in a lot of ways. Skateboarding has taught me a lot about my body and my mind. I have learned a lot of techniques and socially interact with other people in a good way. I'm a foster kid and I moved around a lot and I didn't live in a city. I didn't live in a big city. I love skateboarding. I couldn't really skate that much. I couldn't go skate around town and stuff like that. And I missed out on a lot of young years that I wanted to skate really bad. Then I moved to San Francisco, and I felt like I had a place to belong. I felt like I finally had a home. I'm a happier person and a better skater because I have access to skate parks in San Francisco. If I didn't have access to skate parks, I would suck a lot more at skating. I would feel less inclined. I would meet a lot less of my friends. And I would be roaming the streets, meeting bad people, maybe getting into trouble. And I would be jumping off other people's stairs. I would be grinding people's handrails, going to plazas. We'd always be getting kicked out of spots, getting kicked out of plazas, skating other people's things and not having quite a place for our own. Skateboarding is a positive thing because it gets a lot of energy out of you. It teaches you a lot of things. It teaches you plenty about social behaviors, teach you a lot about people, age groups, respect. Going to a skate park and just learning, oh, these people are doing these lines and I gotta stay out of their way or I gotta be respectful of them. These are strangers, but we still find a common bond through skateboarding. Through skateboarding, we are able to create a little community together. I feel that skate parks make the city better because they allow a safe place for our youth and generally all of our population to skate. Even when you fall, even when you mess up, even when something negative happens through skating, you're still doing what you love and you're still doing something super fun. Think about it. Football players have their football fields, soccer players have their soccer fields. Even at schools, all over the place, there's so many basketball courts, places so people don't play on the street, play in a random grass field that might bother people. If you saw a bunch of people playing football on a baseball field, baseball people would get annoyed. They would want to be playing their games. That would cause a lot of problems in the community, and there'd be no place for this sport to thrive and get there. They wouldn't have their field posts. They wouldn't have exactly what they need for that. Do you want little 10-year-olds like cruising through the streets, kick football off stuff, and then getting hit by a car? Put them in a skate park, they're gonna learn a lot better, they're gonna have a much safer place to fall. A lot of grounds outside of skate parks are super ate up and cut you real bad. Almost all skate parks are built really smooth and you don't cut yourself on them. I think a stigma people have of skaters is that we cause a lot of disruption, a lot of noise, we're reckless, we're rebels, we don't care about authority, we wanna say F the cops and be against all the rules. And skating can be linked to graffiti and it can be linked to some negative behaviors. I would say that's not true because there's a very professional level of skateboarding and not everybody smokes a ton of weed and does drugs and skateboarding, and there's a lot of good positive people in there. And I think we need skate parks to help give a safe environment for these skaters. We will always skate and we will always find ways to continue skating and thriving and building new ways. No matter how hard you try to like push us out, ban skate parks, demolish them, say skating's illegal, people will still skate.
I'm Dante Kasuga, and I'm a psych coordinator at Martin Luther King's after school program. Skateboarding, I say, is my first love. I still skate till this day, but not as frequent as I want to because I have more responsibility now, you know, but I wish I could just skate all day. My favorite things about skateboarding is being able to learn new tricks, right? Because then at the same time builds character, right? Because then, you know, you might try some tricks, you may get hurt, right? Might fall down, I broke a couple bones sometimes, right? But you know, you heal up, then you know, you try to do it again until you learn that trick or until you master it. And also, what else I like about it is being able to just skate around and go to different spots. Like I said earlier, is I got to get to know San Francisco because of skateboarding. Even though I was, you know, this young kid from South City, me and my friends would go out to Redwood City, San Mateo, San Francisco, San Jose, Milpitas. So we were all over the Bay Area just because of, you know, skateboarding. And along with that is that we made, like, a lot of friends. I'm a skateboard and try to do some tricks. Hopefully I don't fall.
No. Okay. Can't stop when I see your face. Smile for me one time. Oh Lord, good grace. Girl, you looking so good and you keep it so fresh. I'ma steal you away and rest me for that. New progression. It feels like we're on a trip going straight to heaven. Can I take you places that you ain't never seen? Across the hills and the lights and the seven seas. Just us, going where we please. No rules, no time, just you and me. I can get it if you want it, if you want it. I can get it, I'ma go get a girl, so I'ma get it. I can get it if you want it, if you want it. I can get it, I'ma go get a girl, so I'ma get it. Flying so high.
A hero to me is someone that helps out the community.
Basically, a hero to me is someone who not only comes and saves the day, but opens up opportunities for myself, like this music studio that we're in right now, you know?
If I was in jail, a hero would come visit me.
A hero would keep the youth off the streets.
was more than just recording. It's about mostly making a difference out of a person's life.
Courage, ambition, motivation.
A hero to me is someone who is brave, someone who is courageous, and is not afraid to stand up for what they think is right.
We all need mentors. Even as adults, you need mentors. You know, you need somebody that, you know, that can tell you that everything is okay. You know, I've been through this, you know, and give you those steady steps.
The city needs a hero.
You can be a hero.
Come and get involved with Sunset Youth Services.
You can be a hero in someone's life.
David Stark. I am originally from Indiana, Knox, Indiana, a very small town, and I've lived in San Francisco on and off for about 10 years. We are at Ocean Beach, California, in San Francisco, outside of Outer Lands Restaurant. I used to draw a lot as a kid, and I think maybe in the second grade or the third grade, I was selected in my school to go to this sort of art camp at a neighboring school where all these other kids from other schools came together. We're sitting in the room with this, with a teacher who's an art teacher, and he's showing us Norman Rockwell paintings, and he's asking us, what do we see? What do we think the painter is trying to convey? And it's the painting was the one with the three young boys with their shirts off and their chest puffed out, and there's this pretty girl walking by, trying to show off for her, and I raised my hand, you know, I think what he's saying is that the young boys are showing off for the girl walking by to try and impress her. I said, yes, that's correct. And from that moment on, I guess I was just drawing and very attracted to doing that, and I've always done it in some form or fashion. It's just a personal thing that's always been part of me.
But I am here and queer, get used to it. This my music, this dyke music. Oh, you like music? Yep, I make music. Take notes, my shit floats, I live broke but feel golden. If those that ain't spoke got some balls and said no, then yes, you have my vote. And yeah, I'll take a toke of that drove for sure. So anyway, like anyway, I rhyme, I find the time between the lines to dive inside the mind of madness with passion. No average chick, immaculate activist, eradicate. No blasphemy, comments are cash and quick. My blood is thick, no tricks retreat, I won't retreat. Hope to speak in belief of G-O-D. He seems to be why songs have beats. Shall I proceed to sing? Maybe not. I'ma walk with my voice. Can you hear it through the spirit? No need to fear him, he's one you can't avoid. So I take his noise and make music, yo. So I take his noise and make music, yo.
And y'all gonna realize